So in the GitHub, what they have for you is I have this tag, which you really don't need in front of you now, but you can have for later. I have a CSV file with data. I'm going to show you things about this data, so you should have it if you want to write code as you work. And I have my own R code, which is already written, but you can also open a blank file and then just type what you do if you want to put it there for your practice. Okay. I'm going to switch from the slides to the R code for once in a while and show you how I do this. Slides are based on a course that was given by Alex Fine, who is kind enough to let me use his slides. Okay, so first I want to review what linear regressions do so that we can see why we don't want to use them, but also what's good about them and what they have in common with it. So regression answers the following question. And I think it's important to remember that this is what regressions do, because we many times just think of them as trying to prove that there is a relationship between something and something. But what they try to do is to identify the parameters of a curve that relates x to y in a way that minimizes and averages how wrong I am about the data. I'll show you what I mean, because this was a complex sentence. But for an example, we want to be able to say, if you give us the IQ of a mother, what will be the IQ of her son or daughter with the most accuracy? So that would be scores in the mother's IQ scores and child's IQ scores, and we want to be able to relate the parameters of the curves, which is the beta, the zero beta and the first beta, so the intercept and the slope. We want to be able to be as right as we can about the score. So if you give me the fact that the mother has an IQ score of 80, I would guess that her child would have an IQ of 70, which is kind of sad. But I would be wrong on most of the cases. But this would be the most logical thing to propose as a value for. Okay. Regressions also allow us to compare the strength of different variables. So in this example, we know the mother's IQ and the mother's age, and we can see that there is an effect of mother's IQ, and it's this strong. There's no effect of her age. So it doesn't matter what age she is, the IQ of the kid will be the same. Okay, but what these regressions don't do is, first, they don't allow us to say interesting things when our observations are grouped in some way. So if we know that we have several observations from this experiment that come from the same participant, or we have several clients of the same social worker, we want to find a way to include this in our data. We don't want to assume that everything is equal. And when we are interested, I know in psycholinguistics, we are many times interested in things that are different between stimuli and different between subjects, or in other words, in between and within subject parameters. So if we have items of different frequencies and we want to know the effective frequency, but we also want to take into account that our subjects are sometimes kids and sometimes adults. So we have between and within subject parameters. Okay, so the IQ data that I showed you comes from 2,972 kids. But interestingly, it comes from several cities. So we have a lot of kids in Atlanta and in San Francisco, in Detroit, and we have just 100 kids in Baltimore and Philadelphia. And from the entire group where we have this data, it actually looks like this when we look at each city separately. So when we look at this, we see interesting things. We see what we wanted to see in Philadelphia and maybe Chicago, but in a really big city in Houston, we see a negative effect of mother's IQ and child's IQ. There's a lot of observations there, so we want to take this fact into account. So what can we do? If we just have a linear regression, we can ignore this and just put all the observations together, which we didn't want to do. Or we can separate and run a different model for each one of these cities, which is also a shame, because we want to be able to say something general about the relationship between mother's IQ and child's IQ. We don't want to say something about this relationship in Philadelphia. So mixed effects models, they are a compromise between this complete pooling and no pooling. And they allow the intercept and the slope of the model to vary. So the intercept was how high our line started, and the slope was how steep it is. Tell me if I'm going too slow or too fast, or same things that are obvious or not. Okay, so intercepts can be thought of. So the intercept in our just a linear regression was the value of y when x is 0. Here we'll take the intercept that are the weighted average of each of these models that I showed you for each city, and the intercept for the model across groups. So we're taking into consideration both the separate groups and how big they are. Bigger group allows for a safer conclusion. And we take the pooled, we also take that into consideration. And I wasn't planning, I'm not going to show you the mathematics around this, but if you want later I can send you something. I was going to just show you how to do this. Okay, so for the overall regression, what we had was an intercept of 56 and a slope of 0.1. But now we'll take into consideration also, we'll take different groups. So, if you are running your own code, we're starting usually every session by loading the packages that we're going to use. I'm not really going to use all these packages, but I always run all the packages that I'm going to need. So you don't have to run everything. I think we're going to use LME4 and MLTest mostly. And if you're not working in R projects, which I'm not going to go into now, you're starting by defining what your directory is going to be. So you have a function, set directory, and you give it the address of your directory that you're going to be working on. I'm going slow because maybe some people want to do this right now. And then what you do is you take, in our case, we have a CSV file with the data, and we read it into an object, which I'm just pushing this file, which has a header. I'm pushing it into an object called D. Just named my data D. And let's see what we have inside D. This is a summary of my data. Okay? And my data is data from a lexical priming experiment in which we had subjects, we had 41 of them, we had items, we had 240 of them, we had, so there's 240 items and 240 trials, and we have the two things that are going to be most interesting for us. So what these persons in the experiment had to do is they saw a word flashing on the screen and they had to say whether it was a word or not. And one of the things that we are manipulating in this experiment is whether it was a word or not. For real. And we have reaction times for how fast participants were for saying if it was a word or not. Okay? I want to read this data again because this is the data I already fixed at home. This is the bad data. Can you tell me what's bad in the way that this is coded? What do you not like about this?
So wordness is like not coded as category?
Yes, okay, yeah. So wordness here goes from 0 to 1. But this is not really true, because 0 means not a word and 1 means a word. So you can't be half a word on average. You can't be half pregnant, right? It actually should be coded as a binary variable. In R, we want to code it as a factor. So what I do in this line is for the object D, for the variable wordness, I want to make it a factor. So I use the function as factor. And now, when I run summary again, I'm going to see that wordness is coded just as yes, no. And you know this wordness, which is the important one, but there are actually a few more. So wordness was not good. Prime is also, there are four different types of primes, and it's not a continuous variable. And item, subject and item are also not really numerical. So a shortcut, instead of running this as many times as we have variables that are not coded. I'm not going to explain why, but if you copy this, you can use it in each one of your scripts to just recode all variables that we didn't like, that was prime, subject, and item, are we going to apply to them factors. So we're going to make them into a factor. So after I run this, our summary looks really good. And this is always important to do, to look at your summary before we start, just to realize that everything's okay. Not just in terms of how it's coded. You have the number of variables you wanted to have, you have the number of participants that you thought you had. So anything wrong should come up here. So we're getting to a model that we want to run. I'm going to name my model MEM1, so mixed effect model 1. And the function that's going to run my mixed effects is ML. And how do I specify what my model is going to look like? I'm going to have my dependent variable first, so that's the reaction time. Then a tilde, so reaction time depends on wordness, which is what we said. We expect that if a word was really a word, it would be reacted to faster than if it was not a word. And then what we have here that is different from the regression that we used to do is we have this once. This is our random slope. So for if we were with the IQ data, this would be 1, then 9, and then C. Does anyone know what this line is called? Because I don't want to say line. No? Line. Okay. We're gonna have a line. The one line subject. This means that we're going to know for each subject what is their mean or what is their intercept. So what is the y going to be if x is 0 for them? What does x is 0 mean in our specific case? It means that it's not a word because we have 0 and 1. So when it's not a word, what will be their average reaction? For participant and for item. So we said this is, well, between subjects and within the same subject for different items. And after I run this, about this script, so we're specifying what the data is. If you're writing something wrong here, then it won't have these variables and you get an error. This you can ignore for now. I'll get to it when I explain other things, but I always keep it inside my code, because why only edit when it's relevant? It's not doing any harm. Okay, so let's say we ran this, we created our object, and we want to look at our object. We're doing the same thing that we did when we looked at D. We're doing a summary of this object. But now we get something different, because this object has different data inside it than our CSV file, right? The first thing we want to look at is this line. So our code gave us the number of observations that the model had, which should look like you expected it to be from the summary, how many items there were, and how many subjects. So this is fine. We know that we have the data that we thought we have. Now it says what the random effects were. So we only had random intercepts for item and subject, so we allowed, we explained what that was. And we can see how much of the variance they explained. So there is a bigger variance between subjects than there was between items, which is something we might need for later. But when you report in your article what you did, you don't report this thing. So what you report and what you usually care about is this, the significance, the beta, and the standard error. So in our case, the only factor we were interested in was whether it was a word or not. And we have the general intercept for the model is 617, so that's the mean for the entire model when word was not a word, when the stimuli was not a word. Your reaction times was 617, and it's significantly different from chance. We don't care about that because we're not interested in how different reaction times differ from chance or zero. What we are interested in is the effect of wordlessness. So when wordlessness was equal to 1, participants were on average 41 milliseconds faster to react than when it was not loaded. And this is significant. Do you know this way of writing? So when you see an E and a minus in your significance, you just write zero, P is smaller than 0.001. But if you want to know how much smaller it is, you can start multiplying this number with as many zeros as you want. You know exactly, but usually you just care about writing that it's smaller than 0.001, right? Okay, so something we won't be interested in when we want to report our findings, what we're interested in is now, is how our random effects really look like. You can run a random effect function on your object, and you actually see for each participant and for each victim how different it was. So in our cities example, you could you plotted this separately for each city, but okay, there are 240 items, and each item starts from a different point. So relative to the overall intercept that we had, the second item starts by being 100 milliseconds slower, but the first is 10 milliseconds faster. Okay, so we can see how our variance looks. Okay, and we'll go back to slides. What we did until now is we only looked at intercepts. Okay. But simply allowing the intercepts of the model to vary is insufficient, because what we really want to know is we wanted to see that in Philadelphia there was a different relationship between mother's IQ and child's IQ. That was more interesting. So we want to also capture the differential sensitivity to mom's IQ. Or here we want to see how different items or different subjects were sensitive to wordlessness. Okay, so yes, this is one qualitatively different, right, from Philadelphia. And if we do this, if we check the different slopes, then we will be able to know if our effects are robust to differences between cities. So what we're really interested in this experiment is not saying anything interesting about Philadelphia, is to say there is a relationship, and if I add another city, I think it would still hold. So when you control for the differences between these cities, you should know if you are able to generalize your results. Okay, so how do we know whether we want to add a random slope for city in this way? We can have a theory. For example, we know that there is a reason why cities should vary in their sensitivity to in the relationship between mother's IQ and child's IQ, because we know they have different policies, so if one is very socialist, maybe there would be less of a relationship between mother's IQ and child's IQ. And empirically, we can look at this our data and say, okay, we want to vary the slope because we see that there are big differences. Okay. How do we do this? Okay, so this is really easy. All we do is we take our one line subject and we add plus wordlessness before it. We have one plus wordlessness line subject. So in this model that I'm running now, this one also has a random slope for wordlessness. And when I run this, I will see something a bit different. I see that the results are still significant, so if that's the only thing you care about, then you get the same result. And I see the numbers are similar in the estimates, but here we see that other than a random intercept for subject, we also have wordlessness. And we have the wordlessness by subject also explains some of the variance that we have. Okay, now we want to know if our new model is better than our old model, okay? Because from what we saw that it's more significant, but this is this one. So a way to check this, yeah, sorry.
Sorry, I might miss something, but how do we know that wordlessness, that subject is accounts for some of the variance in wordlessness? How do we see that?
Here, variance. No. So what was the question?
Yeah, how can we tell that it accounts for it? Like, we see that there is variance in the subjects. We just look and see if the number is high or?
Yeah, the number here is higher than the variance for it.
Oh, this is what we're comparing, okay.
Yeah. We don't have, we're not going to have an objective measure of how much variance it explains. We just want to know what explains the number. Okay, so if we want to compare if our new model is better, what we can do is we can create two different objects. One is our old model, this is the second one, and one is our new model. So I'm creating these two different models. And now there's a function called ANOVA, which doesn't run an ANOVA. It runs a key square test that for the difference between these two, for the difference in the model fit, whether the second model fit is like bigger than the first. Or in our case, whether the first is better than the second is what we're interested in. When we run ANOVA on these two models, we find a significant difference between these two models, telling us that our larger model is better than the model that is nested within it. We can only do this comparison if one of the models is nested within the other. So we can't compare a model where instead of wordlessness, you have luminance or prime, which was one of the factors we had in our data. You have to have two models where one is nested within the other. Usually, we're not going to compare a model with a random slope to one without it. What we really would be interested in for our published paper is to say that the effect of wordlessness adds something significant to our model. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to run two nested models. So I'm going to run the one we found was good, and the same one without the factor we're really interested in, which is wordlessness. And when I do this and run an ANOVA, I find that wordlessness is significantly better than a model that doesn't have wordlessness, an empty model actually, because we didn't have any factor except for a random intercepts and slopes. Okay. And don't be shy, be Monica. Okay? okay. So now you must be wondering what you should put inside your brackets as a random effect and what should be your fixed factors that you're really interested in. So, first, what's the difference between these two? Why don't we just run an interaction between the kid's score, the mother's IQ score, and the city, right? We could do that. But, so that's something we could do in a regression. But an interaction between city and mom's IQ is very hard to interpret. So what do you say now when you get this output? You find there is an interaction between city and mother's IQ. And it's not really interesting. We're talking about the fact that we're not interested in the effect. Well, you can run a study where you're interested in the effect of city on the relationship between mother's IQ and child's IQ, but that's not what we're interested in here. And we're never going to be interested in the effect of subject, right? Was like we did in our model. So why do this to yourself? So when you decide what's a fixed effect and a random effect, there's no hard and fast rule. But I'm going to give you some hard and fast rules. If the possible values of an effect are controlled by you, like in wordlessness, if you are the one that determines if something is going to be a word or not, then it's a fixed effect. That's for sure. You're interested in this effect. If the possible values of our effect are not possible to specify, not interested or infinite, so when you have participants in the experiment, items, it's most definitely a random effect. But you may have cases where none of this, where you're not sure, and then you can think about them. But if you have in your data something you're not sure, means it takes a random effect. Mm-hmm. That's a good time. But if you don't have data, it looks like you have one.
I was just thinking about things like policy, which you mentioned earlier. So if we wanted to test whether a specific policy was better than another one, given that all else is equal.
And it would be a fixed effect.
So it would be
because fixed. Anything you're really interested in and you want to be able to later report if it has an effect or not, is going to be a fixed effect. So I had an experiment that I was manipulating the frequency and testing two different types of population, but I was also controlling for their IQ. I'm interested in saying their IQ didn't have an effect, or frequency had an effect even when you're considering the effect of IQ. Then I need to keep it as a fixed effect. Okay. So you can actually put whatever you want in your random effect structure, right? So how do you decide? Some people will decide based on their data, but I was taught not to do this, so I'm not going to talk about how you decide based on your data. I was taught to do this by your design. So anything that's theoretically significant, which is what we discussed now, the same factor can be theoretically significant in one study, but not interesting in another study. That has to go to be a slope, right? So if you ever tried to run mixed effects model, did you ever get this scary lines? Yes. So generally, I tried to read more about this before the class in case you tackle me with a difficult question of what means that it doesn't convert, and it's not that simple. The simple one-line answer is it means you don't have enough data to specify such a complex random effect structure. And we hate this, so we want to fix this. So two ways we have to fix it. The technical way that doesn't really help you understand your data is what I told you I always include, but we didn't need it in our very simple model. It's a control. If you add this to your code, sometimes things that don't converge, converge. So you can keep the code and try this. But let's talk about the interesting things. So when we get this message, we start by removing factors that are not so interesting. So in the example I gave you about my own data, I was interested in frequency, and for the between subject was literacy, whether they were illiterate or literate. And their IQ is the control factor. I don't really care about this for my design. So I can throw it away and see if the model converges now. Still doesn't converge when the only thing you left inside is what you're interested in. Then you remove items associated with lower variance, which is why I showed you the difference between the item and the stimuli. And you can do cool things, like if you are interested, you can remove only the intercept, but leave the slope. This is something you have just found out. So it doesn't converge, you're not really interested in the intercept, because the more interesting thing is whether your effect looks different for different items or subject. You can specify a zero here, and then you don't get the intercept. You just get a random slope back. And this is not something new, but it's a really nice thing to know. If you write this, I didn't talk about interactions yet, but I'll show you next. If you just write this, then you have the interaction and you don't have the main effects. So if I'm interested in an interaction between your political affiliation and, okay, that's the next example, but I'm just interested in the interaction between these two variables, and I don't really care if your political affiliation by itself has any effect, but only in that interaction I can do this. And this is, you just removed two factors. Like you removed the random slope for factor one and the random slope for factor two, and the only thing you have is a random slope for interaction. Okay, so I tried to come up with something that wouldn't converge for you. Okay, so I added in our model, I added wordlessness here, like we had, the random slope, but also prime and luminance as random slopes per item, okay? And this is a really happy model. The only problem I have with showing you how it doesn't converge is that when you, oh no, it converges now. It didn't converge at all. Oh, okay, fine, great. You have this, which means it's taking really a long time. If it's taking a really long time, it's probable that it's gonna give you the error message. I can wait until it gives me an error message, but you can trust me that I tried this at home and this model doesn't converge. So I can also stop this. And then what do you think will be, well, the answer is kind of here, so I'll try to find it. But what would be the first thing you throw away?
Luminance.
Yeah, luminance is probably not something I really care about there. So I throw away luminance, and now it converges. Now you can do it with it. Well, it still takes a long time because they had prime as a random slope. So the more complex my random effect structure is, the longer it takes. Okay, now it converges and all is well. And I have the different effects of the different prime types and the intercept for item and for subject and for class. So we had our random effect and our fixed effect for wordlessness, right? We coded a word as one and a non-word as zero. But there's also other ways you could do this, and I'm only going to give you the two simple ones today. You can use either dummy coding or some coding. Dummy coding is what we did now. We're saying when a word isn't a word, this is a reference group, which we care about less. And then we have the is a word, which is what we compare to the zero. R always takes the zero and compares everything else to it. So we want to change our coding. We don't want to compare when it's a word to it's not a word. What we want to do is we want to compare each one of these groups to the mean. That's a sum coding. So I'll start with showing you how we do the dummy coding, which is just comparing the word to the non-word. I ask for the levels of this variable. They're 0 and 1. That's what we knew before, just to make sure. Let's call them, because they're a factor, let's call them word and non-word. We just push word and non-word into this. And now, instead of coding this as a dummy, as we did before, we want to sum code it. And we said R will always compare to 0, so if we give non-word the value 0, 1, minus 1, and word the value 1, then it's going to compare them to the 0, which is the mean between minus 1 and 1. So after we define that the contrasts here are minus 1 and 1, when we run our model, which is the same model that we ran before, we are going to get the same significance level. But what we're going to see here, instead of the value of the mean reaction times when this is not a word, we're going to see the mean reaction time for the grabbing of these two groups. And what we're going to see here is the difference between when the word is one and the grabbing. So we see this effect is smaller because it's only 20 milliseconds faster than the grabbing. And when you write a paper, this is something you have to specify, how you coded the variables. It's not going to affect the significance, but it's going to affect the meaning of how to interpret your table results. I can go back to dummy coding this by putting the contrast back to 0 and 1. And then what I see is what I saw before, where it's 617 and 41 milliseconds faster. Okay. I started talking about interaction. So, and the example I was going to give is that rich Americans are more likely to vote for Republicans only if they live in a poor state. So if you're a rich American living in California, you're not necessarily more likely to vote Republican. But if you are in Texas, then you're more likely to vote Republican. Or, more relevant to us maybe, at least for me, the effect of syntactic complexity in reading times depends on the individual's memory capacity. So, if you have good memory, you're not going to be much affected by the complexity of the syntax, but if you don't have that much of good memory, then you're going to have a good effect. So I just said that you could specify only the interaction and not be interested in the mean effect, but if you use this, the asterisk, then you're going to get in your input the effect output, the effect of both the interaction and the mean effect. Okay, how will this look? What I ran in this model is I ran an interaction between wordlessness and leaderless. So we have, you see, we have the same effect. We had the random intercept for item and for subject, and the random slope of wordlessness by subject. And in the fixed effects, we're interested in luminance, wordlessness, and an interaction. So here we're going to say that the luminance had a positive effect. So when you had more luminance, the reaction time was slower. And wordlessness still has a negative effect. When you have a word, it was reacted to faster than if it was not a word. And there is an interaction, which is significant. So can you tell me how this interaction would look like? What happens? No, you can't. Because just from this output, you have no idea how this is going to look. Okay, remove the image of how it could look. But it could be that luminance has less of an effect when it's a word, or that it has more of an effect when it's a word, or that when it's not a word, there is no effect, but when it is a word, there is an effect, or anything in between. So what we do to check how the interaction looks like, we do something that's called the simple slope test, or we draw a graph and we look at how the effects are. So I told you that the code for an interaction looks like this. You see this little asterisk between luminance and wordness is going to tell us that there's an interaction here. This is summary I just showed you. And now we want to see how the effect looks for each one of the categories of wordness. So what we do is we run the same code minus the effect of luminance. And what we're going to have, that's called the simple slopes test. What we're going to have as an output here is we're going to have the effect of luminance when it's a word and when it's not a word. And does anyone understand what this output tells us about how our interaction looks? When it's not a word, luminance has no effect, or it is not no significant effect. Right? And when it is a word, there is a positive correlation or prediction between wordlessness and luminance. So the more luminant the word was, the slower it was to react to. Seems kind of counterintuitive, but it's not my data. I don't know if it's really true for lexical primary, so don't say this. Okay? So this is how it looks in a simple slope test, and you can report this by saying, there was a significant interaction, and to find out how it looked like, we ran a simple slopes test. The simple slopes test found that there isn't an effect when there is a when it's not a word, and if there is an effect, p smaller than 0.001 when it's not a word. And another way to do it is we want to plot our data, and then we can actually see that the more luminant the word was, the slower participants were to react, but when it wasn't a word, there is no effect. So it can help us run the shape. I thought we won't have time for anything, but we really have a lot of time, so I can show you how we graph this if you're interested. We used the ggplot package, where you specify ggplot 2, but there isn't a ggplot 1, so it's okay. I think it's a joke. You specify what your data is, and then what you want your aesthetics to be. You specify what your y-axis is. We know we want reaction time, the dependent variable. We want the x. We want the luminance, because we're interested in the differential effect of luminance in the two conditions. Our two conditions could be specified by the different color. And what we want, what we're doing here with StatSmooth, so the ggplot is the graphic grammar plot. So what we do with this grammar is we specify the first line, and then we can add to it whatever we want. So after a plus, you could say things about how you want these things to look, how big your text you want, how what you want to have as titles. You can add things to what you do. What we add up here is StatSmooth, which is the confidence interval that you want to have around your lines. And you specify what the formula is going to be. In this example, this is just a regression, a linear model, where x, y is predicted by x. But I can add nice things to this. I can do, can add a lot of things. For this example, I want to see, we had our different primes, wordlessness and luminance as interesting factors. So I can ask to see the plots for each prime separately by using a facet grid. So now we see that there's actually something really interesting going on here. We didn't look at prime in our analysis, so we didn't know this before. But now that we've got this, we see that the prime was type 4 prime, I don't remember which type of primes they had, then the effect of luminance on word is crazy and it's positive. But it's negative if it's a type 1 prime. So, that's a great, I usually just see kids and adults differently, which is what I'm interested in. Yeah. So, I don't know, I think the best lesson I can give you about R is that when you want to do something, you know what you want to do, but you have no idea how to do it. For example, if I didn't have facet grid here, but you were interested in seeing an effect separately, you Google how do I see my results differently for each variable, and you always find a response. So what's good about R is that it's a really big community, and it's been here for enough time, where you get answers to almost everything that you want to know. So we're talking about an interaction, and we're saying how important it was to compare two models to see if your fixed effect adds something significant to the model. So now we want to do this for an interaction. We want to know if a model that includes an interaction is better than a model that doesn't include one. So to do this, it's a bit different than what we did before. You create a variable. I call it here D interaction, so the variable is interaction, and I'm adding this variable to D. And to it, I add this code that includes the interaction between the contrast of wordlessness. In this example, I did wordlessness by prime with the interaction that was interesting to me. So I run this interaction, and then I run two different models. I run a model that includes my main effects and an interaction, as in here. And it looks like this. There is, anyone want to read this to me? It's only what I get from an output. I get that the effect of prime that's type 2 and 4 is significantly different than when the prime is type 1, because we didn't recode these variables, so the reference group is the prime number 1, which is probably no prime. And we have the effect of wordlessness, which looks very similar to everything, and the interaction isn't significant. That's the last term. So if the interaction isn't significant, we want to know if it adds something significant to our model. We run the exact same model, but this time we don't want the interaction. So we'll call this object mixed effects model 2. It doesn't have an interaction. So the second model is nested within the first one. And now how do we compare them? ANOVA, mixed effect model 1, and mixed effect model 2. And it's not significant. What you're getting usually in a model comparison is the same thing you got with your significance in the model, more or less, right? So this was, in our model, the interaction had a p-value of 0.1487, and in the model comparison, it's 0.1486. So it's usually more or less the same thing. But it's kind of a sanity check, and it's something that is more accurate to report in your paper than just the values that the package gives you. Okay. So I talked about interactions, and the last thing I was going to talk about.
Sorry, before we talk about this, what does this optimize this thing not to be like, what is the point stuff on the cost?
So,
do we have to have it in the first place? Or
do
we need to have this in the first place in the cost?
So, if your model doesn't converge,
okay,
then you add this. Nice. And there are different types of optimizers. So, if one doesn't work, you Google a model that doesn't converge, and you can find other names of optimizers you can use. That's
what it is. Sorry, you said before that you can only compare nested models. If you want to, is there any way to compare nested models? Yes. So you always have to make a hierarchical thing before, and you have to like present them in order, or just if you have a window for us?
What do you mean in order?
I mean, the way we are putting the ANOVA will detect which one action.
Yes.
There are no need for like ordering them as a variable.
So you meant like, let's say you have model 2, right? And you want to have model 3, which doesn't include awareness and speed. So you can compare 1, 2, 3. Or just, does it matter if I put 2 as the first one? And you can also compare the model that has 2 less variables to the model that has 2 more. And what the way you can see this is the degrees of freedom, so how many variables you had in your model. So now the difference it's not between 10 and 11, it's between 9 and 11. But yeah, it's even more. Now it's significant because you're only 2. So the last thing I was going to show you, sorry, Matthew, was what happens when instead of predicting how fast your participants are going to respond, so something which is continuous. You just want to know if they got their answer right or wrong, so something that is binary. What you're trying to predict in this case, what you want to relate parameters of this loop, is to the probability that your participant will answer that it was a word, and not to how fast it is or she. In my data set, I didn't have a variable to say if the answer was right or wrong. So I'm going to create a variable like this. And I'm going to create this in a way that the results we're going to get are that it did matter if it was a word. So I'm going to create one list that has 4,920 observations, because that's half of the observations that we had in the full model. And for this half of the population or the observations, the probability to get a 1 is 0.8. For the other half, it's going to be 0.2. That doesn't have to be like that. But now we're going to know the parameters that we're getting, and we're going to see in our model if this is really what we get. Because now we know what our data looks like. Now what I want to tell R is that for a variable called decision, which is a yes-no variable that I created, if awarenessness is a word, I'm going to take from list 1. So it's going to be, if it's a word, it's going to be a 0.8 proportion of 1s. So 80% that we get a 1. But if it's not a word, the if-else, it kind of looks like Excel, right? You have the logical condition, and then if this logical condition is true, you sample from the first list, and if it's not true, you sample from the second list. So if I do a summary now of what my data looks like, I have a new variable here, decision, for which you have only like roughly 50%, because what we had here is 0.8 and 0.2, and the mean of these two is 0.5. But we know that this 0.5 is not distributed yet. No wonder that a larger proportion of time. And now we want our dependent variable to be decision and not RT. We're going to predict decision by whether it was a word or not. We're going to run an slope for wordlessness by subject and the random scope for item, the delta is still D. But now we specify that the family of models we're going to use is a binomial one because we have zero segments. And I still have my control. I still have it because mine. And another difference is instead of using the Elmer function, the linear mixed effects regression, we're using generalized linear mixed effects regression. And when we run this interaction, it takes longer because the, it's not converging. I remember I did this to let you see a model that doesn't converge, right? What do we do now? It doesn't converge, oh. Okay. What we can do is we were interested in the effect of wordlessness, so we can have only the wordlessness slope without the intercept and see if now it converges. And our generalized mixed effects models are more spoiled than our linear ones, so they're more likely to not converge. They're more delicate. Now it works. Okay. Great. What we have here, we want to know the significance of your effect, and it's significant, and it's not really surprising, right? Because we build our data that way. But we also want to know what the estimates mean, because up to now we were interested in the 617 milliseconds reaction time that you have, and it's not a word. So the intercept here is the probability that you're going to get a yes response, but in logic space. So when we predict probabilities, our variable is inherently nonlinear. The difference between getting a probability of 0.6 and 0.4 in logic space is bigger than the difference between 0.2 and 0.0. What we want to know, if we want to make sense of this number in probabilities, is we want to turn this, which is the logit of something, back into the number that it was the logit of. So I use the inverse logit function, and I put in it this number for which we want to know what the logit number, the inverse logit is. And what we get here is this 0.19%, which is what? Which is what we determined that the probability of getting a 1 will be if this is not a word, right? I set it as 0.2, but we have some random effects here, so the number doesn't have to be exactly 0.2. So this is really helpful. At least for us, for a sanity check. You don't usually report this, but you can. You can say that, you can. And what we have here, we have what will happen when we add wordlessness to this intercept. What we will have is we'll have the inverse logic, your intercept, plus your effect, 2.83864. And what's the number I'm going to get now?
0.8.
Yes, 0.8. Yay, I got a 0.8. So everything works, and the probability of getting a yes response when you have a word is 0.8. Which is generally all I was going to teach you today. So I'm open to questions.
Just in this last example, where does the where does the random effect come from here?
What does the random effect come from? Yeah. Here?
Why do we have one?
You remember that we didn't put here the main effect, the intercept, we only had the so that's good. I can also add to the GitHub how I usually report these effects in the paper, though you can just Google any paper that uses linear least complex models and see what they do. But I can show you one study and how we report this. So we put the entire table in. I think I can close this, right? We have the entire table in with the beta, the standard error, the z value, and the p value. And then when we need to describe our model in great detail. I'll show you how we describe what we're going to do. So we have a problem with the reviewer ones that doesn't know what mixed effects models are. And then since we had only 30 participants, and in this table we had 10 different factors as fixed effect, we were saying, how can you run a regression with, you need 20 observations per factor, so this doesn't make sense. So ever since then, we specified literally how many observations we have in the model. But I don't think people, it's just a precaution from reviewers that don't know the model. I don't think viewers would do that. But we are very specific in what the dependent variable was, what the factors we used as fixed effects were. Here it was logged frequency, age, short-term memory, nonverbal intelligence, literacy. So we had a lot of fixed factors. And random intercepts. Here, the only thing we had were random intercepts for participants and items. And the reason we only had that is that anything else didn't converge. So I call this a maximal random effect structure that allowed the model to converge. And another thing we like to test many times is the collinearity. So how big is the correlation between variables? Because if our variables are very correlated, let's say in my case it was literacy and IQ, I can't know if the effect of literacy is only an effect of IQ in this case. So I want to report that my collinearity is low. I have a function that does this, but it's not in the code that I can do this. So it's also best practice to just look to see if your model looks okay. And if it's not okay, you need to find out what is so correlated and remove this. And then for how to report this, I report that as predicted, let's look at only the effect of frequency. More frequent toward sequences, more harder to reverse in my case. I report the beta, I report the standard error, the significance. So in my case, what we like to do is we report both the significance that the package gave us and the model comparisons. But you can see it's almost always the same, and you can choose to report better to only report model comparisons than the output of the package. Anything you wanted to know?
Is there a package that you check the different assumptions you need to have to learn certain models? Is there a package for that? Like collinearity or stuff like that?
So for collinearity, the function that I use is a function that someone wrote for my supervisor, but I'm sure that by now, it's been 4 years ever since we got that function, I'm sure there is a package that does that, and you don't have to have my function to do it. For the inflation, for the collinearity, for normal distribution, you don't need to have that if you have logistic regression. It's inherently non-normal. We had a reviewer ask if normality is evident in the binomial distribution. And what I also read about this, again, in that case of a reviewer, because we had different types of analysis, what needs to be normally distributed is not your scores, but the error in your model. And there is a way to, I don't remember the specific code, but it's very easy to Google. How do you find the shape of the distribution of your error in the model, and which is called the residuals. And I know that what they teach us in statistics class is not to do this. A lot of times there is a significance test to see if the distribution of your data is significantly different from normal. The more observations you have in the model, the more likely it is to be significant, like everything. So I think it's nicer to just look at the shape of the distribution. You can graph it, the residuals of your model, and see how close it is to normal.
I thought it was the residuals, the mean, the conditions, not the
within
model
the condition?
Coefficients.
I don't remember whether it's within conditions, sorry. But when I had this problem, so again, I googled this, I found the best resource that I could trust. I found the function to run this, and I report this to usually reviewers, right?
But it uses the residuals that come out of the model rather than...
Yes.
Just doing a manual calculation of
Yeah. You can run. You can use the residuals from your specific model. Yes.
Right. I have another question. It's a bit. I don't know much about it, but I remember looking into mixed models on SPSS, and there was this thing called a covariance structure. Do you know anything about that, or like how it's used? Because I haven't seen it in R. I don't know why it exists in SPSS and not in R. I think it's to do with the random effects rather than the fixed effects.
Covariance structure,
yes.
I'm sure everything that exists in SPSS exists in R.
Mm.
Yeah. I just don't know what it is, how interested in it, but everything that you would want to do, I'm sure you could do it in R. So here, yeah, you have a function for that. One brother sandwich, so you have more time for lunch now that it's